Okay, thanks.
Slide.
So, yeah, first of all, I want to tell a bit about the structure of our talk. First, I'm going to present two projects of myself, and then Bel Roel present one of his previous projects. And then we will shortly roll into how we got to work together, actually. Yeah, so, let's start. So, a year ago, I participated in this hackathon during Transmedia, Rose was also there, where you had to make something and exhibit it in 48 hours. I made actually the first hardware peer-to-peer crypto phone. But yeah, I only had 48 hours, so I had a little trick on my sleeve. I decided that I wanted to like combine like current technology with the most earliest example of long distance communication. So I made an iPhone case with which you can send smoke signals. And this is actually the second version. It uses refillable cartridges from electronic cigarettes. And yeah, you can push a button to send a puff of smoke up in the sky. What's really nice of this method is that it's like super secure. You first have to meet someone in person and decide on a protocol or a encryption key or how you're going to recognize the messages. So you really know who you're sending messages to to make appointments or rules about it. Before that I was actually doing a bit of research into how smartphones and our devices we use every day could look and could work, and I was trying to make my own smartphone using like off-the-shelf equipment. This is more like a official sketch. It had a fake screen. It's just a slideshow thingy. Because I first made one with a Raspberry Pi and like a 4G USB dongle, and you could write a little code and you could send SMSs and browse the internet, but it was like terribly slow. And the dongle and the Raspberry Pi they were using my proprietary hardware. It was like closed source. I wanted to do something different. So I made a visual sketch of how it could look using like a Chinese packaging tape that was used to wrap my products in their orders. So it was more like an official thing. Actually, I want to give the mic to you now.
Okay, and so this is some of my work. This is actually my graduation project from the Utrecht Institute, and I did sort of a research and documentation of tools that people make themselves to make their own internets. So these are all do-it-yourself antennas to increase the range of your Wi-Fi router, and people use this to make their own sort of parallel internet. So this is really on the hardware layer, people looking for alternatives. And there used to be a lot of knowledge around this, especially in the early web when broadband was scarce, and basically people use this to share their DSL connection. No? So a lot of the designs I found were actually old pages which were archived on the web archive. And I made them all to test them. Some of them, like the famous Pringles can, doesn't work. So physically not possible because it doesn't have the right size for the wave. But I documented all these objects in little booklets which I distributed during the exhibition. And another project I made is more of a data design project called Border Check, which is a browser plugin that uses some networking tools. tools that network engineers use to debug the network to actually find out how your data serves across the world as you serve the internet. So in this example, my home router, if you go to bible.com, you can see that it actually goes to the United States. And then this is a bit of a misleading image, but it goes via the sea cables to India and to Hong Kong. And I was really interested in, so where does my data travel and what does that mean for me? No? Like, if I go through all these countries, which laws would apply? Who might spy on me? Which sources can I use to find out this information? So, the beam is really bad. high contrast. Anyway, the maps are white and gray, so you don't see anything. But for each of these points where your data travels, I collect sort of publicly available information, and now I'm working on sort of cross-referencing that to some other things as well. So, for example, if we travel over Capian International, you know, what do we know about this company from Snowden Leaks? For example, from other networks, like big ones, like Level 3, these kind of international cable networks, they really just get mentioned in Snowden Leaks as this is the point where we can collect everything. So that's also a bit about the network of the thing. And so I guess Dennis and me, we found each other a bit in our interest for the fact that there's this issue which really lies in the devices we use. But that at the same time, there's also a potential in the devices we use, and especially if you can, if you start making your own devices and these kind of things. You want to talk about this?
Yeah. 50-50.
Yeah.
There are two mics. So actually, I guess we met through somehow through a WhatsApp photo group we have with a few friends. We just send the crazy pictures to each other, weird things we see on the street, or screenshots of glitches, whatever. We got really tired with all this updating of WhatsApp, and my older hardware couldn't run this app anymore, and I needed to get a new iPhone, blah blah blah. So we were thinking like, we should make like our own photo group device or network, without like providers, without app stores, without Google, without internet. So we researched a bit, looked into software and hardware that was already available, and we found these nice little routers, which are closed source hardware, but you can, the software is actually open sourced because of the copyright. They used
copyleft code in their closed source thing, so legally they had to open up the whole thing, which sort of was the history of the open WRT framework.
So we could code a bit.
So using this, we were thinking, can we not make a sort of network which doesn't use an infrastructure, where you as the person are sort of the infrastructure and are peer to peer. So we really started coding for
a year,
and it's
four people.
And it's still like really crappy and unstable. But the idea of this was really that sort of the device itself would move around and would create connections. So instead of making a label between two computers, just bringing two or a cable, just bringing two computers in proximity with each other would make a data exchange. So from that idea, we also started making prototypes. Like, what if we could, if we go from A to B, we need some points in the middle where we can synchronize. So
some static nodes.
Yeah, can we just maybe put some, one of these routers in the block and just put it somewhere? We could actually tie these routers to sort of our cat, so that when it goes out at night, it can, synchronize some data for us.
You want to watch the new Game of Thrones in the morning?
So these are like that there are experiments, but actually worked, and so based on a tram, and then the route of the tram sort of becomes your network as well.
And since 1 month we have image recording now?
Yeah.
And emoticons?
Yeah.
There's also text only, but... yeah, but we also, we got a bit tired of going, of course. We wanted to make something
around. Make stuff.
Make stuff. So we made some nice images, some like rotating GIFs, and we modified the free BV logo to say like free internet. So instead of wireless internet and get a cable, we thought, yeah, let's just make this. It'd be actually amazing. So Warren, that also supports us, also thought it was a good idea, so we built this,
yes.
This device.
And now the cafe in Warren is the first free internet cafe in the world. and yeah, funnily enough, we got quite some press for this, and everybody wanted to know how secure is it, you know, because Wi-Fi in the cafe is like a nightmare, don't do your banking there. And we were glad to say that the big advantage of this system, because it's still an open network, but at least you know that the person who's spying on the network is in a 3 meter radius around you, because that's how long the cable is.
That's really good for long parties, so if you ever want to organize one,
I think we have 100 megabit speed, and there's a 1 gigabit connection as well to the outside. So it's,
there's only 1 gigabit. 1 gigabit. Cable,
yeah, yeah, so
one special cable going on there.
Also going, you know, from our experience with Wi-Fi and wireless communication, we're also looking at, we're using these routers, which is annoying, but can we not build some kind of radio transmission device ourselves to really sort of do your own network? And we sort of started diving into this long history of radio art and
pirate radio,
microtransmission. And there are a lot of really interesting zines and resources on how to build your own radios. So we've been teaching workshops on how to build your own radios. We've been trying to make the RML, the radio market language, so that you can transfer data over the radio.
Yeah, so this example is a circuit from you got it from Zeke's radio part.
Yeah, it's like this famous scene from the 80s, the radio part scene, which contains all these
schematics. And these are like really easy or really basic components you can find everywhere, you would think. But it's getting harder and harder to get these like discrete components, because everything is now like SMD, like super small. You can barely see it anymore. So if you rely on Chinese leftover stock and fakes, it's really funny, because you do a lot of hand work and you can just draw a circuit and push the components in, and it works like magic. It's also like really magical.
So this is a bit of a later design.
This is the later design you can see with less components, about 8 or something. The idea is that you plug it in your laptop. You, during the workshop, you make one specifically designed for your own laptop. And you put it into a USB in your audio port, and it gets power from the USB, and you can send anything